Hello guys, welcome to today's video of Yen146 here. So today we'll be doing another classical game analysis. We had many games that were sent in, so we'll try and take them one by one. And this one was played by Mr. Philip Amekum. This was back in August this year at the International Meeting of French Speaking Countries. He represented Ghana there. Now this was around round 5. He played a very strong women's grandmaster with a 2200 rating. Mr. Philip was black, so we'll look at the game from his perspective. It was a very interesting game. He played very well in the beginning. He completely had a win in his grasp, but then a few mistakes here and there that we'll take a look at cost him the game in the end. So she started out one knight f3 with a ready opening, and then Mr. Philip replied with c5. Now he plays c5 after almost any white first move, e4, d4, knight f3. He plays c5 and he's very comfortable in the setups that result as after shantytowing the bishop. So he's quite experienced in these structures. She went for a very solid kingside fianchetto in the red team. So usually when they start with one knight f3, it can transpose into d4, d5 openings, depending on how they continue. It can transpose into a Sicilian if they go e4. But then she continued with the red team opening. And then he also responded by fianchettoing his bishop as well. So by move 6, you realize that there is complete symmetry on the board. Both kings are castled kingside. Both bishops are fianchettoed. The knights, the c pawns, the board is completely symmetrical. So the game was almost equal at this point. Now maybe she didn't like that, so she decided to change the structure by playing e4. Now we can look at it with the opening explorer to analyze the opening. Here in this position, by far the commonest move is one d5. And it makes sense. It starts to resolve the center. And because it's symmetrical and white goes first, if they get to strike in the center first, they can retain some advantage. So continuous c takes and. But then you realize that e4 is one of the least common moves. And when you look at the scores here, you realize it's a bit of an inaccuracy. White scores very badly generally in this line, with black rather winning more often than not. So we'll look at why it wasn't so accurate in a bit. Black replied with d6. She played h3, bishop e6, and now we go out of games that have been recorded. So the few master games that have reached this position, black went for 98 more often than not. A few times went for a6, bishop d7, and then knight d7. So let's try and look at the reasoning behind these moves. Now in position 6, well, we have this symmetrical position. The key factors here are that because of the c pawns being advanced like so, each side has a temporary outpost in the opponent's camp. Yes, white has this d5 square, black has a similar square on d4. Now it's only temporary because these pawns can still control those squares. But then by lashing out with e4 and attempting to change the structure, well, it doesn't seem like she changed it in her favor. What the move e4 does is, for one thing, it blunts the light square bishop, making it not as good, especially when you compare it to this one that still has the whole diagonal to play around with. And the second thing that it does is that it now makes the d4 square a complete outpost. Now there's no pawn that can defend that square any longer, so black can take full control of it. Whereas the corresponding outpost on d5 Although e4 supports it more, it's still not a complete output because the move e6 can still be played sometime in the future. So the two ways that the move e4 changes the structure don't really benefit white. So I think it may have been a slight inaccuracy, and the opening explorer confirms that. So generally, white scores very badly here. So she could have continued with d5 like we've seen, and then that would probably have transposed into some Catalan structures that you may already be familiar with. So Mr. Philip played d6, which is correct, a solid move. For one thing, you don't want him to advance e5 for free. You want to protect that square. You're also hoping that the bishop for its development. And she replied h3, with the idea of stopping the bishop from coming to the g4 square. Mr. Philip developed the bishop to e6 then, which is also a decent move. Typically, in the structures where you play bishop e6, you wait until the c-file is open. And the reason is that you want to combine the pressure that the bishop has here with the rook here on c8. Without a second piece to attack that pawn, after it's defended with, say, d3 or b3, the bishop becomes a little pointless. Now, it's not really doing so much. Because she did play d3, and now it's difficult to see what the purpose of the bishop is. So, in structures where the c-file is still closed, sometimes the bishop can play b7 and b6 and put the bishop here on b7 and just have it oppose white's strongest piece for now. There are also ideas of where it goes to d7 and eventually it can come to c6 sometime in the middle game. But I mean, bishop e6 was also decent. And then she did play d3. And then he played queen d7, trying to take advantage of the move h3 to gain some tempo on the king by seemingly forcing king h2, which he played. However, there was also this move knight g5, which she didn't consider. But then it holds the pawn and then attacks the bishop. It basically forcibly wins the bishop. And you don't really want to give up your bishop pair that easily. This bishop is always better than this knight in many positions. So the move queen d7 was actually not super accurate, but then she didn't find knight g5, so yeah, it didn't really matter. And now he played h6. Okay. So with the move queen d7, we can use this as a point where the game transitioned into the middle game. Now black has developed almost all of his pieces with the exception of this guy. White is left with these two pieces to develop. So let's try and look at the structure that we have in the middle game. So out of the opening, you can see that black has a slight edge. It's close to equal, but black has just a slight edge because of the effect of the move e4 and the fact that he has this output square. And in certain middle games, the pawn on d3 can also become backward and weak. He is able to open up the d-file. When you take a look at the pieces, the knights are fairly equal. The dark square bishop for black is stronger than the light square counterpart for white because of the move e4. But then black's light square bishop is also not super great. And you can imagine that white's dark square bishop will probably do a better job if it should come eventually to some square like e3 and then supports the eventual break d4. So it's still fairly balanced. Now, what are the plans that you'd expect in the structure? For black, we look at it from black's perspective most of the time. When you look at the pawn structure, you realize that they have a chain pointing towards the queen side, which means it will be easier for them to gain more space here on the queen side. So the typical plans have to do with playing a6, b5, rook b8 to support that, and then opening up the queen side where you have more space. And generally, those lines tend to favor black. You get some coordination with a bishop, a rook on the b file, you may even double there. And that's the simplest way to play this position. Python, on the other hand, has perhaps more options. One of the benefits for that they got from the move A4 is that they changed the structure such that they don't just have a chain pointing here, but they have a chain that points in two directions. So they can decide to either expand towards the queen side, much like black can with A3, B4, and rook B1. Or because they also have the possibility of creating a chain towards the king side, they can also decide to expand on the king side instead of the move like knight to D2 and play for F4 and the king side attack. So this structure in the center gives you more flexibility when it comes to the side of the board to play on. So it'd be very tough, for example, for black to play on the king side here. But then it's easier for white to decide to play on either side of the board. So these are the general ideas that they both could have had. So after h6, trying to stop the bishop from coming to g5, white played a3 and then started expanding towards the queen side like you mentioned. But you realize it's a little slow. Black has such good control of the b4 square that it's very difficult for white to complete this expansion. So black also did the same thing with a6. Rook b1, rook ab8. Now this may have been the point at which he should have continued with b5. But then she played another move that was also okay, knight d5, taking advantage of this output square that white has on d5, which is another reason why the move bishop e6 perhaps may not have been the best. You realize that because she played e4, black could have dominated the d4 square without giving white the opposing d5 square. And the reason is because he would still be able to play his pawn to e6 instead, taking control of that square. But now because the bishop is in front of the pawn, the square is still effectively an outpost because the pawn can't really do anything to that knight. But what this move also did was that by slowing down white's queenside expansion, she allowed Philip to rather take the queenside with the move b5 first. And as we'll see later on, that queenside became the key to the rest of the game. She took c6, and then he played very intelligently, took with the rook. Typically, you take towards the center, but then you realize that not only do you close down your rook, the a file that is opened up is not going to be very useful to the rook either because of how strong this pawn on a feels. So it was better to take with the rook and then make use of this open file, put some pressure on the b2 pawn. Together with the bishop here, you're looking to double soon. And that more than makes up for the weakness of the a pawn, which is quite difficult for him to attack. Now, perhaps she was already feeling some pressure. She started playing for some tactical shots. She took on f6. Usually, she wouldn't exchange the strong knight, which is basically a best piece at the moment, for the knight on f6. But then, she was looking to try and stifle Black's progression. And the problem here is that if you take with the bishop, she's saying she has a free pawn here on h6. Although when you look at the follow-up rook to rook f2 b8, you realize that pawn will also fall. So it wouldn't really have been a problem. He could have still taken with the bishop, but then he still chose to take with the pawn and then keep the h6 pawn defended, which is also fine. What it does is it makes it slightly more difficult for the bishop to become active. She played queen e2, developing the queen, hoping to connect the rook soon. And then Philip played rook f2b8, continuing the theme of gaining more space on the queen side, putting pressure on the b2 pawn. Now it's always going to be tricky for this bishop to develop because of the pressure on the b2 pawn. And if the bishop can't develop, he can't connect his rooks and complete his development, he's always going to face issues in the middle game. Now she played g4. And this is the idea. Because she played knight takes, forcing him seemingly to take with the e-pawn, shutting out his bishop, she wants to stop the move f5 as much as possible. If black is able to play f5 and free up the bishop again, because of takes, maybe bishop takes, then the whole idea of giving up her knight would have been for nothing. And then black would still have a lot of pressure on this point and would probably fall soon. So she played g4 to stop the move f5 as much as possible. Now, here he played rook e8, which is one of the few moves in the middle game that perhaps weren't so accurate. And I believe the idea was to force through f5 still. You can imagine if white makes, let's make some random move. The idea may have been to still play f5 because of the rook x-raying the queen. So she can't easily take twice because of this tempo that he gained. But I don't think that was really necessary. For one thing, if you do want to play f5, you probably can, is what I thought, because you don't really care much for opening up the position. The thing is that white's king here, it's probably weaker than black's king here, even if the king side becomes opened up. So I don't see why you can't still just play f5. And although your king is slightly loose, I think his king is weaker than black's in this position. And you get these beautiful bishops. And don't forget the weakness on d3 also becomes a problem. So I think you could have still played at 5 without the rook e1 e8 move. But he did. And then black replied with rook e1, basically saying that you still can't do that because then she'll just be able to take the rook. So then black played the move g5, which was when I first saw it, I thought it couldn't be very good because it makes it all that much more difficult to achieve the f5 break to open up the bishop. So the bishop is basically doomed to be behind this blockade of pawns. If the bishop should come to f8, the picture is not much better. There is still a blockade on d6. So basically for most of the rest of the game, this bishop is going to be a bad piece. So I was struggling to understand why the move g5 was played. But after I realized it makes quite some sense. Basically, you know there are three parts of the board, the center, the king side, the queen side. Right now, black is much better on the queen side. He has more space, he has pressure on the pawn, and white is not looking so good. It's called for white to complete their development. The center, although is not locked, it's not resolved in any side's favor. So by closing down the king side with g5, he's basically saying the important part of the game will either occur here on the center or here on the queen side, where he is much better. So by closing down the king side, he directs the game towards the side where he is better. And now white plays bishop e3, which was actually a good move. But then her next move undid all the good that she did here. Black plays rook d8 again. Now that the king side is locked, he's piling all the pressure here on the queen side. And she played bishop c1, just going back again with the bishop. Now, the reason why bishop e3 was the good move was that, again, it's basic principles. Whenever you are being attacked on one flank, it's usually a good idea to open up the center if it's not locked. Because once the center is open up, the center is the most important part of the board. So you shift focus from the side where you are losing towards the center. So bishop e3 was a good move because it prepared the move d4. And after rook b8, that is the move that she should have played. Opening up the center and then making it less important that you have this pressure on the queen side. Now you're basically forced to take here, and the game is now going to be played in the center. Now things like the weak pawn on d6 become relevant, the outpost on f4 become relevant. Now he can play ideas like even b4, rook here, and then you can see that white is getting some play, because in the center there's still a lot to be resolved. But then by going back with the bishop to c1, that passive defense basically may have caused it to enter a lost position. He built up the pressure with rook b3, now also eyeing the weak pawn on d3. There are also tactics where the rook can take the pawn on a3 because of the undefended piece. So white played king h1. I'm not sure what exactly it does. Maybe just getting off this diagonal prophylactically, because the position may open up soon. Apart from that, it doesn't do a whole heck of a lot. Black replied with h5, which is also a very, 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 very good move. Now, you realize because of the king stepping up, this pawn becomes a little weaker. So you never really want to take here and then allow black to take on h3. But then if you don't take, then the pawn on g4 is also going to fall. So now all of a sudden white is facing pressure on both sides of the board. She played knight d2, attempting to hold the pawn down with the queen, and then claiming that they were getting a tempo here on the rook. But it simply doesn't work. Now Philip replied with knight d4, which is a very understandable move, getting tempo on the queen. But there was a shot that was even better. You could have simply taken h takes g4. Now, white can't take back, because then you just win a pawn with tempo on the queen, and you protect your rook after that. So white is basically forced to take the rook, and then you continue taking. You take on h3, and you have tempo on the bishop. If the knight is just to retreat, you're going to take the bishop, and you'd have gotten a piece, the bishop, and then two pawns, or effectively one extra pawn for the rook. But then the other part of the exchange is that you have managed to get his king in an extremely open and vulnerable position, which is more than worth the giving up the pawn that you gave up. And black is just much better. This king is not going to survive. So because of that, she may be forced to give up the bishop this way. But effectively, it's the same thing after saving the knight. The same material imbalance with the king in a lot of trouble. So that was a shot that he could have gone for. But I mean, it's very understandable to miss that, seeing that you could attack the queen with tempo and then get your knight onto such a strong square on outpost square on d4. You can't really be faulted for playing that instead. And then he saved the rook, because black is still much better in this position. You know, like missing that changes the evaluation much. She took on h5, which was part of the reason why the queen went to f1 to hold the pawn on h3. But then they still left a lot of light square weaknesses here on the queen side. And so he played knight c2, hitting the rook, rook d1, then bishop a2. And now you can see that because white is undeveloped here, he's facing all sorts of trouble. Even if the bishop had been on e3, if d4 had been played, all of this would not have meant much. But then because he's still so badly developed, he's all of a sudden losing material. Now he can't avoid losing some material. And so she has to play for counterplay. And she does very well in this phase as well, which is a good lesson for all of us. Whenever you're in a bad position, you need, instead of defending passively, it's always better to play for counterplay. Even if objectively your move may not be as good as the passive defense move, even if the engine says the best move is some passive defense move, it's always better to play for counterplay than just to sit and watch your position. So she went for f4, attempting to open up black's king, maybe get some attacking chances. Now this move, it's objectively speaking, it's not very good. The reason being that it makes the e3 square available for the knight to fork these two, in addition to this guy already falling. But then, practically speaking, you create some complications regarding your king. So, if you play knight e3, queen f3, knight takes rook a1, and then he played bishop b3, saving the bishop and attempting to defend the knight. Of course, it doesn't work because knight takes, rook takes, and then queen takes. And in this position, black is an exchange up for a pawn. Now, there was a better way to convert from here with a move queen a4, but it's very tough to see, and you won't blame anyone for missing this. Where the queen rather defends this knight, forcing him basically to take the bishop, and then you play queen c2, taking advantage of the bishop that isn't developed, forcing him again to play rook a1 to hold the bishop, and then you play knight takes on b2. And the idea is that this guy is now weak. The knight is not going to just die like it did in the last variation. So the best move here, I think, is something ugly like bishop f1, which no one wants to do. And the thing is that if the bishop takes here, you rather take this knight instead of taking the bishop. Because again, the bishop is it doesn't have a whole lot of squares to go onto. If it tries to do something like this, you're going to play rook b1 and just pin it, and that's an extra piece. So bringing the queen into the action with queen a4 to c2 would have made it much simpler to convert. But again, it's not a very easy move to calculate over the board. And you can understand that he missed that. And again, the evaluation is still much better for black. He's an exchange up for a pawn after from here. So he played queen b5. Here there was yet another tactical shot associated with the move c4. Again, not so easy to see. You can pardon someone for missing it, but it would have made the conversion much easier. The idea that we're just taking the pawn if you don't do anything, and if you take it, you have this shot rook takes h3 check. If bishop takes, queen takes, king g1, and then the other rook comes to b3, and it's coming here with very, very disastrous consequences. So that was apparently the best move. But then he played queen b5, the similar idea of hitting the pawn, which is also decent. Bishop f1 to hold the pawn. Queen b7. Now, White played queen g4. And according to Philip, after she played queen g4 here, she offered him a draw. And there's something about the psychology of competition, especially when it comes to draw offers. You may hear some stories about some of the strong masters who, whenever they offer you a draw, you should immediately take it, because if you don't, you probably are going to go into some trouble. And maybe there is something to it. Maybe there's some sort of confidence that comes in when someone offers a draw in a position that you know is better for you, where perhaps you feel like killing off the position immediately. Because of course he rejected the draw for black is just better here, but then he immediately played a move that wasn't very good, and from here white had much better chances than before. He played d5, opening up the center. Now it's good to I mean it's easy to see why in the short term you may think d5 is a good idea, trying to open up the king and get more on this diagonal. But then you realize that long term, this diagonal does not belong to the queen but to this bishop. Whenever the bishop opposes here, the queen will have to go away somewhere else. And black doesn't have a light square bishop to take advantage of this diagonal. So opening it up long term rather favors white rather than black. And in general, opening up the center in this position may just be a bad idea. So when you assess this position, White has the extra rook in exchange for black has the extra rook in exchange for white having an extra bishop. But that extra bishop gives him a bishop pair, and a bishop pair is a very unique pair of units to own. They can control a lot of squares, especially when the center opens up and the opponent does not have a bishop pair. So the best way to deal with the bishop pair is to either keep the position closed or to exchange one of them off. In this position, it's a little difficult to exchange any of them off since your bishop is quite stuck, quite bad. So the best thing to do would have been to keep the center closed as long as possible. So opening it up with d5 created these long-term issues, and you will see very soon how easily the bishop pair dominated the board. So he played d5, she took on d5, and a better move would have been something along the lines of queen e7 to try and give extra protection to this pawn. Maybe go for a queen exchange with queen e6. So d5, f takes, bishop takes. And now he played queen c8, looking for the queen exchange. So he could have also played queen c8 here. That also probably would have been better. E takes. Now he doesn't mind exchanging queens. Now when you do a count of the pawns, you realize that white has more than 2 pawns in exchange for the exchange that he's done. And although he's going to lose this one, in the end it's going to become 2 pawns for the exchange, which is especially when the extra piece gives him a bishop pair, which is more than enough compensation. So queen took on g4, the h pawn took back, then the bishop took on b2, and the rook took on b2. Perhaps the bishop may have taken to also win this pawn in addition. I don't know what the time situation was, if there was some time trouble element here too. But the rook took. Rook e1 was played. Bishop d4, and all of a sudden from here white is suddenly doing better. White has this pawn that is threatening to queen very soon. The queen in square is already controlled by the dark square bishop, and the light square bishop can very easily offer up support of this pawn on these squares. So it was already from here already difficult for black to hold this position. So white started pushing with d6. He played f6 to blunt off this bishop. Bishop came to f4. Rook d8 to hold the pawn. Bishop g2. Bishop e5. And that was the final blunder. Missing the fact that this rook is on the same diagonal as this bishop. Bishop d5 was played. King h8. And puzzle rush, help you spot the tactic. Rook takes. And you can see how the bishop pair are just dominating the center. All these diagonals. The most important diagonals in the game are the long diagonals. And they also intersect with the center. So they are dominating the important parts of the board. Rook b1 check to get out of that. And then he took back. And although you have two bishops against two pieces, which should be much better for the rooks, here the bishops are just completely dominating the game, and white is much, much better, already winning. For one thing, it's very difficult to stop these three pawns. One of them is definitely going to queen, and that's exactly what happened soon. So bishop e4 check, king g8, h6, and already the bishop controlled these two squares, so it's game over. Try to hold with rook d7, h7, check, give up on bishop. And after d7, the rook is not in time to stop the last pawn. And so he basically resigned nicely with rook g1 check. He might as well resign in style. So it was a very interesting game, certainly, with a structure that I wasn't so familiar with, these c4 structures. So it was a bit of a learning experience for myself as well. But like I mentioned, Philip played very well in the beginning and the early middle game, and if only he had found some of the tactical shots that finished the game of c4. H takes on, I think H takes on move 22. Yeah, H takes on move 22. And then c4 somewhere move 30. Yeah, c4 here. Either of those would have ended the game, but even in spite, I mean, they were difficult to see. So in spite of not seeing those, he still was better until the decisive mistakes that started with d5. Because even from here, you could have still exchanged off into a winning pawn. But then after d5, it was already very difficult, and very soon the game was completely bust. So that was the game. Thank you for tuning in. I hope you benefited from the analysis. You can also send your games in for analysis if you'd like. For some of the videos we'll be making, I'll make a few more of these game analysis. I have a few more games that others have sent. And I want to do two more series. I want to do a series on the end game and a series on the middle game, where I take a look at how to make a plan, some of the various pawn structures and the common plans that are typical with them, and how to assess these middle game positions. So I'll try and work on that and then do some interesting games as well. So thank you for tuning in. Have a nice day. Enjoy your chess.